My name is Pastor Hal York, and we'd like to welcome you to our online service here at Hastings Park Bible Church. That's January the 10th, 2021. And hard to believe we're this far into January already. Seems like Christmas is a distant memory in some respects, but we're still in lockdown, as you know, and we'll be in lockdown for a couple more weeks, it looks like, unless things change. And so we just are hopefully praying that these things, this will dissipate quickly and we can be able to start having services back together again. And so we're just praying that the Lord would we'd find a solution to this quickly. But we know the Lord still reigns. And as we read earlier, and as the verses were there for you to meditate on, the last verse is, be still and know that I am God. And that's not bad advice any time, but especially in the days that we're living in. And so we should get caught up in anxiety and anxiousness as we watch our television. And sometimes it's good to just maybe to write some of these verses down and stick them off to the side of our television so we can read them and we can evaluate what we're seeing. But even better, maybe just to write them down and stick them right on the front of the screen and turn the TV off and be reminded of what Isaiah tells us about who God is, and be still and know that these things are true of God. Let me just read some verses as we start, just to encourage your heart. Isaiah chapter 45, it says, is it not I, the Lord, and there is none other God besides me, a righteous God and a Savior? There is none except me. Turn to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth. For I am God and there is no other. I have sworn by myself, the word has gone forth from my mouth in righteousness and will not turn back. That to me every knee will bow, every tongue will swear allegiance. They will say of me, only in the Lord are righteousness and strength. Men will come to him, and all who are angry at him will be put to shame. In the Lord, all the offspring of Israel will be justified and will glory. Then in chapter 46, these wonderful words. Remember the former things long past, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things which have not been done. Saying, my purpose will be established and I will accomplish all my good pleasure. Calling a bird of prey from the east, the man of my purpose from a far country. And truly I have spoken, truly I will bring it to pass. I have planned it, surely I will do it. And I pray that those verses would encourage our hearts today and remind us of who God is, that our God reigns and our God is in control of this world. He's in control of everything going on around us, everything controlling, everything going on in this world. We know our God reigns and rules. The nations are but a drop in the bucket, it says in Isaiah chapter 40. We need to be reminded of that and be still and know and be assured, and be confident that our God reigns and rules.
Thank you.
1 Samuel 15:1 to 23. Then Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you as king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, listen to the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he set himself against him on the way while he was coming up from Egypt. Now go and strike Amalek and utterly destroy all that he has, and do not spare him, but put to death both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey." Then Saul summoned the people and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 men of Judah. Saul came to the city of Amalek and set an ambush in the valley. Saul said to the Kenites, "Go, depart, go down from the Amalekites so that I do not destroy you with them. For you showed kindness to all the sons of Israel when they came up from Egypt." So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. So Saul defeated the Amalekites from Havilah as you go to Shur, which is east of Egypt. He captured Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen and the fatlings, the lambs and all that was good, and were not willing to destroy them utterly, but everything despised and worthless, that they utterly destroyed. Then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, "I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me and has not carried out my commands." And Samuel was distressed and cried out to the Lord all night. Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul, and it was told Samuel, saying, "Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set up a monument for himself. Then he turned and proceeded on down to Gilgal." Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said to him, "Blessed are you of the Lord, I have carried out the command of the Lord." But Samuel said, "What then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears, and the lowing of the oxen which I hear?" Saul said, "They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, but the rest we have utterly destroyed." Then Samuel said to Saul, "Wait and let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night." And he said to him, "Speak." Samuel said, Is it not true, though you were little in your own eyes, you were made the head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed you king over Israel? And the Lord set you on a mission and said, "Go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they are exterminated. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord, but rushed upon the spoil and did what was evil in the sight of the Lord?" Then Saul said to Samuel, "I did obey the voice of the Lord and went on the mission on which the Lord sent me, and have brought back Agag, the king of Amalek, and have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took some of the spoil, sheep and oxen, the choicest of the things devoted to destruction, to sacrifice to the Lord your God at Gilgal." Samuel said, "Has the Lord as much delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is as a sin of divination, and insubordination is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king." May God bless the reading of his word.
Well, as we think about our church, we think about what's going on in our church, just a couple of things to remind us of. There will be no services, as we know, on Sundays, and no prayer meetings or children activities for the next few weeks. And again, we're praying that will not continue much longer than they said. But we do want you to know the church is open. And my office, I'm here in my office most just about every day. And you're more than welcome to come in and have a chat if you'd like, or just to drop by and say hi, as many are doing. If you'd like to continue to give, we know many are, and we appreciate that. And we thank you for your faithfulness. You can give at the back of the carport. There's a mail slot there. You can drop into the office or slide it under the door in the office. And or just drop it off when Fiona's here. And but we thank you for your faithfulness. You can mail it in as well, your tithe in as well. But we thank you for your faithfulness and your willingness to continue to support Hastings Park. And we know you love this church. And we thank you. And we're looking forward to getting back together and being together as his people and his church.
And I know many other churches in town feel the same way. We're looking forward to getting back together. And we need to be praying for that. We also want you to know that the library is open. And you're welcome to come in and get books if you'd like and take them home and read them. I know that several people are doing that. And you're more than welcome to come. Make sure you call before you come just to make sure the church is open. But if it's open, you're more than welcome to come and to check out the library and take some books home with you and catch up on your reading during this lockdown. We want to continue to pray for Karen Scrivens, and she's continuing to improve bit by bit, but she's got a long road ahead of her, and just pray that there will be no more complications, that the Lord would help her get her strength back, and she'd be able to, her breathing would improve as well, but we know she's in the Lord's hands, and we just pray there'll be her continued healing. Think of Pat and Barb as well, and Clara Sargentson, who are going through some, Clara's has cancer, her cancer has come back, and so we just need to pray for her, and others who are going through just periods of loneliness and difficulty, and we know it is difficult, and just remember to pray for them. Pray for our nation, pray for our countries, what's going on in the United States and the leadership there and what's going on in our own countries as well. We need to pray for our leaders, as we said last week. That's one thing they should be able to count on, is that they're being prayed for. And so we need to pray for them and uphold them. And no matter what we think of them, we need to pray for them. They're there by God's ordination, by God's design, as we looked at last week. So let's just have a word of prayer once again, and then we'll look into the Word of God. Father, we are thankful for your grace. We're thankful for your mercy. We're thankful for the salvation that we have in Christ. And we thank you that we can come together and have this word in front of us, this word of God that we can't understand. It's inspired of you. It's written by you. It's God-breathed, and it speaks to us with truth. It speaks to us with authority. It speaks to us with sufficiency and clarity. And so we thank you for that. We can understand it through your Spirit who lives within us. May he teach us this morning as we open it and study it together. We also want to thank you for your mercy and upon us on a daily basis and your hand of healing that you do. You touch, we know that you can heal, and we know that you can reach down and intervene in the lives of your people. And we pray, Lord, for Karen Scrivens. We continue to lift her up and pray for her healing, continued healing, and as you give the doctors wisdom, and there'll be no setbacks, and she'll continue to regain her strength, and we just commit her into your care. And for Pat Ferguson as well, and Barb Reed and Clara Sargentson, who are struggling with physical infirmities, we pray that you might just be near to them and their families. And Lord, others who are struggling with their health, and I think of Loretta and Ron and Carol, and others, Father, who are just going through difficult times, we pray your hand might be upon them, but also that you might meet them, Lord, in their loneliness. It is lonely not being able to get out. Many of these people have been going to church their whole life, and not to be able to meet with other believers is very, very hard. And we've all experienced that in these last few weeks and last few months. And so we just pray that we uphold one another in prayer, be encouraged, and encourage one another, and just look forward to that day when we will be able to get back. But we thank you, Lord, that you are still on your throne. We thank you that you are building your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And we pray you'll continue to do that and use us as your vessels, and we might be fit for the master's use, and we might be proclaiming the good news of Christ. We pray for our leaders that you would strengthen them, give them courage, give them wisdom, and help them to understand that the power they have is the power that's been given to them from you, and that they would lead in a way that is good. But Father, we just pray, Lord, that your hand would be upon them to protect them. We know they're there by your ordination, by your design, and we just submit to them and pray, Lord, that they might lead in a way that is pleasing to you. And we might pray that there might be a mighty moving of your Spirit in Ottawa, in Toronto, in Washington, and around these nations, Lord, where we see nations, Father, and we see the morality of our nations, and they're getting further and further away from you in their thoughts, and the intents of their hearts are just becoming more evil and more wicked day in and day out. And we need a revival. We need a moving of your Spirit and your people and your church, that we might be the church. We might be shining as lights in the midst of a wicked and perverse generation. So use us, we pray, for your glory, for the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we We pray now as we open your word together that you might just touch our hearts as we look at this subject we'll be looking at. It's a very important one. And we pray, Lord, that you might just help us to understand it, to think clearly about it, that your Spirit, Lord, will guide us into truth, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. There are many, many people who come to church week in and week out, who sit in the pew week in and week out, and they've been doing it for years and years and years. But in that, as they sit there, as they read their word, the Bible, as they listen to the Bible being taught, they're saying there are some things they just cannot accept about what Scripture says and what Scripture tells them to do. They will not accept God's instructions to them. They will not accept what the Bible says about morality, about sexual purity, about sex before marriage, and all the other stuff being taught today and propagated today. They will not accept what the Bible says in regard to those principles of biblical morality. So what appears to be submission is really just happens to be an agreement to a point. But when our ideas and our values and our opinions clash with Scripture, what happens? That's what I want to talk about this morning. What happens when our ideals, our ideas, our values, our opinions clash with Scripture? For many, we will not bow the knee to Scripture. We are still the king in our own kingdom. And we guard it maybe silently, and maybe we don't talk about it, but we guard it firmly and we will not budge. We may be nodding in agreement on the outside, but screaming on the inside, there is no way I'm doing that. There is no way I'm going to believe that. And that is no small thing. That is no small thing. And so we need to think about this for a few minutes. And what I want to do this morning is look at a few examples from Scripture to help us think about this and cause us all to examine our hearts as to how we view the Word of God, how we view Scripture. Who is the ruling authority in my life? in my life's choices, in my life's attitudes and actions? What would you say? Then we all would say the right thing outwardly. But God knows our heart. And when God calls us to examine our hearts, he's not just calling us to examine if we know we can check all the boxes off on our theological scorecard. When he calls us to examine our hearts, he's calling us to examine who is our master. Who do we follow? Who has our ear? Who do we listen to? Who is the final authority in our life? And I want to look some examples as we look at Scripture. And I'm going to be reading quite a bit of Scripture to drive this point home. A very familiar story in Luke 18 about the rich young ruler. We know the story, but I think we need to hear it. He says, a ruler questioned him, saying, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother. And he said, all these things I have done or kept from my youth. And when Jesus heard this, he said to him, one thing you still lack. Sell all that you possess and distribute it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven. And then these words, and come, follow me. But when he heard these things, he became very sad, for he was extremely rich. And Jesus looked at him and said, how hard it is for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. He had no problem with the commandments, at least the ones relating to men. All these I have kept from my youth. Now we know he didn't keep them perfectly, and Jesus knew he didn't keep them perfectly, but it just shows what he thought about himself. But really what he's telling us here in some respects is he was the poster boy for the church youth group. He was brought up right. He won all the Bible contests in the youth group. What could be the problem? He seems to have a good heart. He seems to know the commandments and he's kept them. But Jesus looks at this young man and says, one thing you still lack. And I want to be reminded this morning, all it takes is one thing. One thing, one heart attitude. How are you doing? The question Jesus calls him to do answers the question, how are you doing on the first four commandments? You shall have no other gods before me. So here was a young man who had everything going for him. He was well off. He was religious. He was moral. And he just wanted to add Jesus to his portfolio. He just wanted to make sure he was going to heaven when he died. And so he comes to Jesus and he says, you know what? What must I do? Because that's all I'm lacking. And Jesus says, you know, one thing. Sell everything you've got and come follow me. I got a question, young man. Who is the final authority in your life? Who is the ruling authority in your life? And the young man answered it by walking away. I can't follow you. I think it was the fact that Jesus called him to follow him even more so than he called him to sell his riches that caused this young man to walk away. Because most rich people, they could sell everything they've got and get it in a few years, have it all back again. They're just that kind of people. But Jesus didn't just tell him to sell everything he had. He said, you need to change your whole life. The authority in your life has to change. And I want you to come and follow me. Come follow me.
This didn't make sense, I'm sure, to this young man. Why do I need to do that? I worked hard to get these things. And I'm sure that deep down in his heart, he says, I don't think that's right. I'm not sure if he knew Jesus was or not. He was a good teacher. That's all he knew. But he wasn't willing to do what this good teacher told him to do. Jesus says, go and sell all you have. And he was sad. He was rich. Riches were his God. Really, self was his God, his own kingdom. And what is the one thing in your life? Is there some area of your life that you will not bow the knee to what Christ calls you to do? Is there some area of your life that Jesus has said this to you, I want you to do this and follow me? You say, I can't do that. Maybe it's submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution. Would that be your one thing? Maybe it's to submit yourselves to your servants, to your boss, to the good and to the unreasonable. Would that be your one thing? Now we know, and I'll talk more about this in a minute, but we know there's more than one thing. But the issue here is, who is the ruling authority in our life? Is there some area of your life that is hands off? God has no right and has no purpose and no place in that part of your life to tell you how to live it or what to think about it. That is the test. Because if there's one thing in your life you will not do, it means that all the other things you do for Christ are because you are obedient to Christ, but simply that Christ is in agreement with you. You are still the ruling authority in your life. You have not died to self. You've just found that Christ was pretty much amicable to everything you believed, and everything you believed seemed to be amicable to him. But when the push comes to shove, when you get to that crossroads, you are going to come down on the side of self, because self is the ruling authority in your life. You say that Christ or the Word of God is the ruling authority of your life as long as you agree with it. But you're judging it, and you will not allow it to judge you. And when you come to a difference of opinion, your opinion wins. Your understanding, your will rules. And what it does is it shows that pride is still very much ruling in our hearts. The question of who is Lord of my life is not a subplot of your life. It is the only plot of your life. It's the determining factor of your life about where you will spend eternity. Who is the Lord of your life? Who is the master of your life? The passage we read earlier, I think, illustrates this. 1 Samuel chapter 15, and again, is a very important passage. And you remember the dialogue between Saul and Samuel that we read, and Saul and the people, after God told him to go and destroy everyone and everything, because they were a wicked, vile people. And they had no part. God wanted to have nothing of them in the camp, in the children of Israel, around them. Nothing. But verse 9, after Saul got this command from Samuel, from God, to go and do this as the king, as the leader of Israel, verse 9 begins with that ominous word, but. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen, the fatlings, and the lambs, and all that was good. Now listen to these next words. And were not willing to destroy them utterly, but everything despised and worthless that they destroyed. But the problem was, God said everything about the Amalekites was despised and worthless. He didn't leave it up to them to decide what was despised and worthless. God said it all is, and I want you to destroy it all. But that's what sin does. That was the problem all the way back in the garden. They ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and we became the judges of what is good and evil, not God. And that's what happened to Saul and the people. And then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me. He has not carried out my commandments. He didn't say he almost carried them out. He says he hasn't done what I called him to do. Almost in the eyes of God is nothing. And Samuel was distressed and cried out to the Lord all night. And Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul. And it was told Samuel, saying, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set up a monument for himself, which tells you something about Saul. And then he proceeded on down to Gilgal. It sounds like Saul was pretty pleased with himself, pleased as punch, if you will. He probably thinks Samuel's calling him to tell him what a wonderful job that he did. And that's how deceived we can become. And Samuel came to Saul. And Saul said to him, Blessed are you, O Lord. Where Saul said to Samuel, Blessed are you of the Lord. I have carried out the command of the Lord. I have carried it out. I did what the Lord told me to do. But Samuel said, What then is the bleating of the sheep in my ear, and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? And Saul said, probably no doubt pretty proud of himself, They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and oxen to sacrifice to the Lord, your God. But the rest we have utterly destroyed. Saul was utterly convinced he had done what God told him to do. But it was only according to his own agenda, not God's. What he deemed good was what was going to be the ultimate authority as far as what was good. God was not going to be the one who dictates how Saul carries out his commands. Saul would be a better judge of good and evil than God was. And that's what all sin is. We are becoming better judges of good and evil than God. He said he obeyed. But there was something about the situation to Samuel that didn't set right. Samuel may have been thinking to himself that old Christmas song we just came through Christmas season. Saul says, I have kept the word of the Lord. I have obeyed God's word. And Samuel may no doubt have been saying or thinking, well, do you hear what I hear? Do you hear what I hear? I hear you saying something over here. I have kept the Lord's commandment. But over here, I hear the bleating of sheep and the lowing of oxen. And Samuel knew something. Dead sheep don't bleat. And so Samuel, the very thing that's going on here betrays Saul's disobedience. The bleating in the ears of Samuel are saying Saul did not do what God told him to do. And so he says in verse 22, that great verse, as the Lord has much delight in burnt offerings, he brought these sheep back for a burnt offering, and he thought that was a greater compliment, a greater act of worship than obeying what God told him to do. But he says, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. It's better to do what God told you to do the way he tells you to do it, than to break that commandment and to disobey under the guise of worship. It's better to obey than sacrifice. Then Samuel makes an astonishing statement. What he calls what Samuel did is rebellion. For rebellion is as the sin of divination and insubordination. This is iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you from being king. And then Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned. I have indeed transgressed the command of the Lord in your words because I feared the people and listened to their voice. Now therefore, please pardon my sin and return with me that I may worship the Lord. Here's a guy that just does not get it. Saul's response, if I could paraphrase, verse 25 was simply, whoops, sorry about that. Please forgive me. Will you pick me up on the way to church? That's how small Saul thinks this is, what he did. He does not get what he's done. It's no small thing to defy the living God. I don't care what your reasoning is. There's no small thing in the eyes of God to have a rebellious heart to his commands. To say, I'm not going to do it your way. I'm not going to do what you say. I'm going to do what I think is right and what I think is good. Saul revealed his heart. And God removed the kingdom. And Saul continued to reveal his heart after he says this, as we know, by trying to kill God's replacement for him, chasing David all over the countryside for years, trying to kill him. That reveals Saul's heart. Pride always minimizes sin. Oh, it's not a big deal. Confess it and get on with your life. This quote, a German poet, a journalist, Heinrich Heine, lived from 1797 to 1856, and he supposedly gave this answer when a priest asked him on his deathbed if he thought God would forgive him for his sin. He says, of course God will forgive. That's his job. And that's kind of the same attitude Saul had here. Whoops, sorry I did this. Let's go to church. His defiance and his arrogance and his pride, all dressed up to look nice, but God sees it as a very ugly thing. Listen to this quote. I'm not sure who it's from, but it's very important. Pride will kill you forever. Pride is the sin most likely to keep you from crying out for a Savior. Those who think they are well, look not for a doctor. As seriously dangerous as pride is, it's equally hard to spot. When it comes to diagnosing our hearts, those of us who have the disease of pride have a challenging time identifying our sickness. Pride infects our eyesight, causing us to view ourselves through a lens that colors and distorts reality. Pride will paint even our ugliness and sin as beautiful and commendable. We can conclude that we don't struggle with pride because we don't see pride in our hearts. That's the danger of pride. Pride is a master of disguise. A master of disguise. It is the first sin. It's a sin that gets Satan kicked out of heaven. It's a sin, in essence, that Satan was appealing to. You shall know good and evil. You should be like gods in the Garden of Eden. Pride is a master of disguise. It has a form of godliness but denies the power. It has a dresser full of masks for every occasion, and we're all wearing masks nowadays, so we understand that illustration. It has a mask that says humility on it. It's a false humility, but it's a humility. There's a mask that says it loves you, it flatters you, but it's a feigned love, it's a fake love. It's a love that's designed to set you up. It's a love aimed at getting something from you. It's not genuine. It's not real. Jesus says they worship me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Flattery is a form of veiled pride because it looks like humility. It looks like you're my best friend. But you're really just setting me up. It's hiding the knife in your hand that you're going to stab me in the back with. Pride is a master at excusing sinful behavior. Unforgiveness and bitterness and anger and disobedience. And pride is a master of justifying those things. And on and on and on we could go. You go back into the garden in Genesis 3, and once sin entered the human race and pride came in, it was just what? It became a blaming. Adam blamed the woman blamed the devil. Basically, she's blaming God. They're just blaming everybody, and it gets down to it was God's fault. But that's what pride does. But there's another story in the Bible. It's in Genesis 22 about another test.
It's in Genesis 22, a familiar story. And again, permit me to read it. Now it came about after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. And he said, Take now your son, your only son whom you love, Isaac, and go to the Mount of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on the one of the mountains of which I will tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son. And he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place which God had told him. And on the third day, Abraham raised his eyes and saw the place from a distance. Abraham said to his young man, Stay here with the donkey, and I and the lad will go over and worship and return to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son, and he took in his hand the fire and the knife. And so the two of them walked on together. And Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and said, My father, he said, I am here, my son. He said, Behold the fire, the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? And Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. Now I'll just jump down to verse 10. He laid Isaac on the altar on top of the wood, and Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, Here am I. Here I am. And he said, Do not stretch out your hand against the lad and do nothing to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Now I can think of many, many ways, the scenario of that, if that had been me, that I could have worked at to get out of doing this thing that to me would make absolutely no sense. It would not be hard to justify in our minds that this just can't be right. I must have heard him wrong. How can this be? I could have thought of several ways. You just forget the knife. Just forget to bring the knife. But he doesn't. He takes the knife. And that, to me, is worship. Like too many times we come to worship and we leave the knife home, the hard thing, the thing that was going to prick closest to our heart, that the thing that God calls us to do, that may be the hardest thing we can ever contemplate doing in our life, the knife. Hebrews 11 says, By faith Abraham, when he was tested, and it is a test, remember that, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was offering up his only begotten son. It was he to whom it was called. It was said, And Isaac, your descendants shall be called. And he considered that God is able to raise people even from the dead, from which he also received him back as a type. Now think about these two stories, Saul and Abraham. Saul spared Agag, this wicked, wicked king of a wicked, wicked people, and he spared the sheep of this wicked, wicked people that God had told him to utterly destroy. They were a vile, wicked people. Saul spared Agag and the sheep and what they deemed to be good that God said to destroy. Abraham took his knife to sacrifice his only son, this son that God had promised him for years and years and years. And finally, miraculously, Sarah has a child in her old age. This child who would be a blessing to all people, whose seed would be like the sand of the seashore. And Abraham, by faith, obeyed and did exactly what God called him to do. And God saw his faith and said, Abraham, Abraham, stop. We know that's a beautiful picture of the cross as well. Saul, according to his own understanding of people, chose to deliberately disobey, rebelled, obeyed as they saw fit, and God took away the kingdom. God said, that's unacceptable. That's not what I called you to do, called you to do. And I want you to listen very carefully to this quote. Pride is a state of mind, or more essentially, a condition of the heart in which a person has supplanted the rule of God over his life with the rule of his own will. Did you hear that? Pride is a state of mind, or more essentially, a condition of the heart in which a person has supplanted the rule of God over his life with the rule of his own will. Instead of depending entirely on God, as was God's design, a proud heart now looks to itself to decide what is good and evil. And this was exactly the folly of Abraham and Eve when they determined to disobey God, to become like God. When we get to the crossroads in our life, these places where we have to choose, crossroads where Scripture leads us to time and time again, areas of our life where obedience is going to be very difficult or go against our own agenda or our own understanding of good and evil, where it goes against cultural opinions and expectations, where disrespect and rebellion is the cultural norm. When we get to these crossroads, who do we obey? Do we obey God or what seems right to us? What is right in our own eyes? We become the judge of good and evil and not God. Who is the ultimate authority in your life? When it comes to following Christ, is there one thing you lack? One thing you will not give up? It's not that you struggle with it, but you know what the Bible says and you just refuse to do it. You refuse to do what it says or believe what it says. You will not bow to the Scripture. That Scripture. And when you do that, you're really showing the only reason you bow to the other ones is because you think they're okay. You think you're okay. For you, it might be verse 13, submitting yourselves to the government. Verse 18, submitting yourself to a boss. It might be another one. It might be another one. But remember, the rich young ruler did not walk away confused. Saul didn't say, I was confused and I didn't understand. The rich young ruler did not walk away from Jesus confused. He walked away sad. He understood what Jesus said. It was a very simple concept. Sell what you have and follow me. It was a simple message that didn't leave him confused. It just revealed the rebellion and the hardness and his unwillingness to follow Jesus Christ. He left not confused, but he left still lost. He came looking for eternal life and he left without it. Not because he didn't hear the words, the way to come to it or get it, because he wasn't willing to do what Christ told him to do. He left without hope and without Christ. Now, I want to remind us of something here. You could take this and say, well, all your sounds like all you're telling us to do is just try harder. No, that's the last thing I'm telling us to do. None of us are perfect. But if you know Christ, you can say with David and Paul, in your heart, that you long to obey. David said in Psalm 40, I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. And we don't always do what our heart longs to do, as Paul says in Romans 7. We do sin, and we do disobey. But when we do sin, we humbly, with a contrite heart, confess, and God forgives. David was a man after God's own heart. He delighted to do his will. He fell into sin, we know, Bathsheba. But we know that his heart was genuine because that sin crushed him. He couldn't sleep. He tossed and turned, as Psalm 32 says. It ate away at him. And he finally, humbly confesses what he's done because his fellowship with God was broken and he just tossed and turned. He stumbled. The flesh overcame him, and he sinned. And we all struggle with the flesh. But that's not what Saul did.
David just didn't say, I think I can do whatever I want. I think it's okay to take another man's wife. He was tempted and he gave in and he caved in. He committed adultery. Saul's sin was not due to weakness of heart. It was a deliberate choice to not obey. It's not a transgression of a changed heart delighting to do God's will, but the willful, settled resignation of a rebellious heart bent on having its own way. He was not confused. He was simply unwilling. And there's a big difference. He was not tempted. He was simply unwilling. He was not willing to obey the command of God, and that's a different matter altogether. And I've said all that to say this. I think while it may never be said and talked about, there are a lot of people sitting in churches all over North America who for years, who've gone to good churches, who sat there with smiles on their faces and Bibles on their laps, who have a truckload of sheep bleeding in the parking lot. They're sitting in church, reading the Word, secretly in their hearts. They take what they like and reject what they don't. They're nice people, friendly people, even generous people who talk about God. But in their heart of hearts, deep down, when it comes to push, when it comes to the bottom line, when they think comes to things in Scripture, they do not delight to do the will of God. They say, we will not have this man rule over us. We will not have this word rule over us. Everyone's doing right in their own eyes, and they think most of the Bible is fine, but it's those few pieces that they don't, they are the final judge, which means they are the judge of all of it. They are the master. As it's been said, if Christ isn't Lord of everything, he really isn't Lord of anything. We just pretend he is. John 8:47, he who is of God hears the words of God. For this reason you do not hear them, because you're not of God. John 10:3, to him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he puts forth all his own, he goes out ahead of them, and the sheep follow him. Why? Because they know his voice. And even though he leads them through the valley of the shadow of death, they will follow him. Why? Because they know his voice. When we get saved, we don't know or understand what the Scripture says about everything, obviously. But Christian life is growing, and as we grow and learn Scripture, there will be areas of our life where we see the need to change our behavior and our attitudes. And maybe how we, if we're a young person, what we're doing on our dates with those of the opposite sex. Maybe you grew up in a totally pagan home and you got saved at camp, but you've never heard, no one ever told you that sex before marriage is wrong, because everybody's doing it. In our culture, they say it's perfectly fine. And so maybe you've been tempted by it, or maybe you've given into it because you're thinking nothing of it. But then you read in the Word of God that it's wrong. And if you're truly born again and saved, your heart is going to be convicted, and you're going to say, I need to change. I need to stop doing this. I need to understand that that behavior is wrong and I can't do that anymore. And there are many, many other things that we learn, and we're always constantly learning. And we're constantly changing as we respond and bow the knee to the Word of God and the authority of the Word of God in our life. The believer's heart delights to know and obey God's Word. And as we learn, our lives begin to change slowly but consistently to become like Christ. As MacArthur says, it's not the perfection of our life, but the direction of our life that matters. We long to do what is right. We long to please the Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. 1 John 2:3 says, by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. The one who says, I have come to know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him the love of God has truly been perfected. By this we know that we are in him. Now I wanted to close with this. This is not
a sermon that's telling you to try harder. You need to try harder to be saved. You need to get your act together to be saved. We are not saved by our obedience. We are not saved by trying harder. We are saved by Christ's obedience and His perfect righteousness being imputed to us. We are saved because Christ was perfectly obedient. There's none of us that are righteous. No, not one. No, not one. There's not one thing about us is wrong. Everything about us is wrong. But Christ died on the cross for sinners. He died on the cross for your sin and my sin. And if you've trusted Jesus Christ, you've been what the Bible calls justified. You've been declared righteous because of the obedience and sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. He died for you and He rose again. And that is a legal declaration. You have been legally declared just in the eyes of God, and you've been declared that by God Himself. Our sins have been laid on Him. But salvation is more than just a legal declaration. It's a declaration that our sins have been laid on Him, yes, but it's also a declaration that His righteousness has been imputed to me. I am clothed in the perfect righteousness, the perfect obedience of Christ. That's how I know I'm going to heaven one day, because of the perfect righteousness of Christ that's been imputed to me, and because all of my sin was imputed to Him when He hung on the cross 2,000 years ago. But salvation is more than just a declaration. Salvation is also God being born again to a living hope, as Peter says in chapter 1. It's being born again by the Spirit of God. It's you who were dead to God have been made alive in Christ. We have become a new creation. We've been given a new heart, a new life, new desires, new passions, new drive, a love for the Word of God, a love for Christ, a passion for His church, a passion for His people. And that life has evidenced itself by the things I've just mentioned. The new birth means a new heart. And I delight to do His will. I delight to obey His word. We don't always do everything we'd like to do. We fall, we stumble, we sin. Then we confess our sin, and He's faithful and just to cleanse us from sin, forgive us our sin, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, as we know. But it doesn't. Our obedience adds nothing to our salvation. It simply shows the reality of it, that our life has been radically changed. That we now love the Word of God, and we're submissive to the Word of God, no matter how hard it is in our own thinking to wrap our minds around it. We walk by faith and not by our own understanding. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. We walk by faith. And the fact that we walk by faith and in obedience to Christ is not how we are saved, it's an evidence that we are. And when we sin, we confess it. And we come to the Scriptures, we don't have this rock of hard, solid rock underneath this veneer of godliness. And we look good, but there's still this rock of rebellion. We struggle with the flesh, as Galatians says. We wrestle with flesh and blood against flesh and not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. We wrestle against the flesh. We're in a spiritual battle, and all of those things are true. But it's only true in the life of the one who's truly been born again. Because for the one who's not been born again, the flesh is still sitting on the throne, and there's no competition. He'll tolerate some things that it makes him look good. He'll tolerate things that sort of makes him look Christian, but he's not going to do the things he doesn't think are logical or good. He's only going to follow the dictates of his own heart, lost heart, rebellious heart. Let me close with one more passage. Luke 6:46. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? Everyone who comes to me and hears my words and acts on them, I will show you who he is like. He is like a man building a house who dug deep and laid a foundation on the rock, and when a flood occurred, the torrent burst against that house and could not shake it, because it had been well built. But the one who's heard and has not acted accordingly, it is like a man who built a house on the ground without any foundation, and the torrent burst against it, and immediately it collapsed, and the ruin of that house was great. It's not a parable about a house, but about a foundation. One had one, the other one didn't. It's the same house, same storm. But one had a foundation, and that foundation is faith in Jesus Christ and his perfect righteousness that's been imputed to us. And that's what we're trusting in, his merit, not our own. We're saved by faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast. But it is a faith that is not alone. It is a faith that is accompanied by works to give evidence that we have indeed been made alive. We've been given a new heart, a heart of flesh. We're being changed and transformed into the image of Christ. We're a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. And we have a heart that longs to obey and delights to obey the Word of God. That is not the foundation. That is the evidence that we are founded on the rock, Jesus Christ. Eternity is what's at stake here. Heaven and hell. And I want to close with a question, two questions. Are there any sheep bleeding in your life? Is there some area of Scripture, something about Scripture? And we may not understand it all. Nobody understands it all. We're constantly learning. But are there areas in your life that you do know what Scripture says? It's not hard to understand, and you're having a hard time swallowing it. And you've come to the point where you say, I'm not swallowing that. I'm not doing that. I'm not obeying that. I'm going to do what I think is right, what I think is good, what I think goes along, doesn't make me stand out like a sore thumb in our culture. I'm not doing that. I'll do this because I think it's okay, but I'm not doing this hard thing, this difficult thing. I'm not taking up my cross and following Christ. I'll take up my cross. I'll decide what the cross looks like, not Christ. I'll decide what has to die, not him. I'm still in control. I'm still working and building my kingdom, not his. Are there sheep bleeding in your life? Do you delight to obey the word of God? These are not small issues. These are foundational issues. These are at the very heart of who you are. Who you are. None of us are perfect. We're going to sin. But when we live in a constant, habitual sin, signifying that we think it's okay, it's going to rule my life, and I'm giving it permission to rule my life, I don't see anything wrong with it, I'm going to live like this, I don't care what anybody says, and most importantly, I don't care what Scripture says, whether it's calling you to stop something or to start something. That's a very serious issue, a very serious thing. And you need to stop and examine your heart. More importantly, you need to stop and ask the Holy Spirit to examine your heart, to see if, in fact, you are a believer, because that's not how believers live. That's not how believers live. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. He's been born again by the Spirit of God. And I pray you can say, with Abraham, that you've done all God called you to do. You've believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. You asked him to come into your heart by faith. You realize it's not of merit, it's not of works. And we've had people leave this church because of that one fact. There's nothing you can do to save yourself. And they said, I can't buy that. I can't live with that. I can't believe that. And my friend, that is building on the sand, because the judgment day is going to come. And they're going to stand before God clothed in their own righteousness. And they're going to be cast into an eternal hell. These are not just little things. rebellion in the eyes of God is like idolatry. Rebelling against God's word is a big deal. To know the truth and not to do the truth is a big deal. We struggle, we're going to fall, we're going to stumble. But our heart confesses that our heart is broken by that sin, and we confess it and we say, God, give me the strength and to obey you. And he does. I long to obey your word. I long to obey it. This is the thing that we have to grapple with as we go through this book of 1 Peter. Because we're going to come time and time again. This is where the rubber hits the road. We're how we live, and he's going to be talking about how we are to live in this world, and he's going to call us to some very difficult things, hard things. But he will give us the grace and the power to do them for his glory and for the good of those around us. And may we be willing. May we be willing to say, Lord, do unto me according, may it be unto me according to your word. Whatever he says to you, may we do it. And do it with joy and delight in the power of his might, working powerfully in us through his spirit. Let's pray together. Lord, take these words and drive them deep down into our heart. Father, may our heart be captive to your word. And your word alone. We pray, Lord, that this would cause each of us, Father, and we all have to look at this and do a heart check and ask ourselves, who has my ear? Who has my heart? Who is the authority in my life? Who is Lord of my life? And so, Lord, I pray that you might just take these words and use them to your glory in the hearts of your people. And maybe there's someone listening to this who's maybe beginning to realize and search their own heart and realize, you know, they've never truly bowed their knee to Jesus Christ. They're just going along and doing what they think is right. But they know there's things in their life that they don't bow their knee to. May you convict them of those things and show them they need to come to Christ. Or they need to confess it and say, Lord, I give it to you. Whatever you say to me, I will do it. So we thank you, Father, for the gift of salvation. That to know you is to know our sins have been forgiven, that we've been clothed in the perfect righteousness of Christ. But that justification will lead us to this life we've been talking about. It's a life that we struggle in. We wrestle with the flesh. We wrestle with the world. Pride of life, all of these things are still there, still real, but our heart has been changed and we long to obey you. We long to be like you. We long to feed on your word. And so, Father, may these things be true in us. And may you strengthen us. And may we continually be seeing more victory upon more victory as we become more and more like Jesus Christ and conform to your word for your glory. So work in us powerfully and mightily, we pray, through your spirit. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.